Hi, welcome to the Marsh. Of course, this is what the Marsh is now. Sometimes it's my living room, and sometimes it's your living room. Tonight, in fact, one of the living rooms we will be in is up in Portland, and we're hoping that the windstorms they have there will not impact it enough that we won't be able to hear from Johanna Courtleigh, who is one of our performers tonight. You're going to be hearing all new work tonight. So people have been coming on Zoom and working together to try to find some inspiration between the pixels and trying to put something together that might have something to offer you. And until you show up and give us some kind of reaction, we don't know what we have. So thank you so much for coming and helping us to complete this process. Most of you will be muted tonight because I'm sure you all know that Zoom becomes insane if everybody's unmuted. So we'll have a couple of people who are not to create a little bit of an ambiance, but we would love to hear your reactions in the chat. So please consider responding that way. Our format tonight will be a little different than usual. We have three performers who have pieces that are 15 to 20 minutes long. And then we have a fourth performer who is going to be doing some short pieces in between the other pieces. So we have Theresa Donahoe and Johanna Courtleigh and Wynd Kaufmyn, and then our person who's doing the short pieces is Ady Abbot, and I think you'll enjoy all of them. So without further ado, I'd like to turn it over to Theresa Donahoe. Thanks a lot for coming.
It's a beautiful evening, and I'm watching the sunset. I'm watching the sunset with a neighbor who's on her second glass of Pinot. Tonight, the sky changes colors from orange to yellow, then pink, Instagram. Turns out it was worth it. Be racing up the hill on my flip-flops. After taking multiple pictures, we say our goodbyes. She walks down the hill one way, I walk down the other. I get in my car, I take my mask off, and I notice the cute yellow house on the corner across the street. The lights are on, but I don't think anybody lives there. I drive back to my studio apartment, and everything looks so pretty on the outside. When I'm outside, everything looks the same as it did before, and I can almost be fooled into thinking that life is normal and we're not being asked to quarantine during a pandemic. 5 minutes later, I'm home. I live in Oakland, but the neighboring town of Piedmont is where I go to catch a sunset. Oakland, California, a city with a reputation for diversity. Urban hipsters, crime, current number of COVID cases, 7,728. But just a stone's throw away from where I live is the city of Piedmont, a town known for its lack of diversity, great schools, and mansion-sized houses. Current number of COVID cases, 33. I live so close to Piedmont, I share a zip code with them. 94610. It's a 5 minute drive or a 15 minute walk to the city border. Is your block Oakland or Piedmont? That was my friend Andrea, back when she used to give me a ride home from the gym. We used to take a hip hop class together a couple of years ago. Suddenly having to relocate, she was looking for a new house in Piedmont so her kids could continue their education there. My block is Oakland. Bummer. See you later, T-Money. T-Money, my pop nickname. Shortly after that, Andrea found her third home in Piedmont within 8 years. So resourceful. The next evening, I'm back again in that same hilly Piedmont neighborhood, hoping to catch another epic sunset. I park my car again in front of the cute yellow house. There's always a parking spot in front of the yellow house. The mail is piling up. I begin to stroll. There's teddy bears everywhere, all of a sudden, being displayed inside people's front windows. Inspired pandemic artwork is popping up. Mostly pictures of rainbows drawn by children with the phrase, "We're all in this together." Aww. Oh, would you like my daughter to make you a sign for your house? Oh my gosh, this woman thinks I live here. Well, I don't let her in on my secret. That I'm merely an imposter, wandering around an affluent neighborhood, old enough to appear to be a homeowner, fair-skinned enough to look like I could live in Piedmont. But I think about my mother. If she walked these streets, would people assume she was the hired help? The next day, I go on a morning walk. I like to take pictures of athletic squirrels attacking bird feeders, as well as the neighborhood cats for my Instagram feed. Well, you see, I live in a rent control apartment with a strict no pets policy, and I gotta get my feline fixing somehow. And I like to think that the neighbor's cats know me. Yeah, there's the friendly short-haired ginger. Meow. The skittish calico. And a black and white fluffy cat named Felix, who is a ham for the camera. Felix, you are such a cutie. I know. I overhear a couple of the neighbors talking about the shelter-in-place mandate. We had to cancel our trip to Hawaii. We had to cancel our trip to Costa Rica. I try not to judge. When the quarantine first hits, my mother sends a group text to her four adult children. Good morning, everybody. Are you kids all still able to work? Me. I'm working from home, Mom. Government job. Mike. Just working on cars, not really dealing with people. My brother Steve. I gotta work. You can't stop treatment plants from running water. My sister Lynn. The cops are here because ladies are fighting over toilet paper. Big lady pushed little lady in the face with her hand. That's right. My sister works at Costco. It is chaotic. Work in the front lines during a pandemic, but she finds a silver lining. Costco stock is on fire. All these panicking members are good for business. As I continue my daily walks, I start to discover hidden steps, what they call secret stairs, that cut through the hilly Piedmont neighborhoods. Oh. What's that humming noise? Oh my God, it's bees. It's bees! It's bees! Okay, now, the city of Piedmont used to be a neighborhood of Oakland long time ago, but annexed itself, becoming its own city in 1907. And in the Roaring Twenties, it was known as the City of Millionaires. Piedmont is broken up into three groups. Lower Piedmont, which is basically Oakland. Central or Baja Piedmont, where the City Hall, Police Department are. And Upper Piedmont, where the mansions are located. Yes, Piedmont has a caste system. The following evening, I'm back again in that same hilly Piedmont neighborhood, also known as Scenic Avenue. I know the name sounds like it should be part of Upper Piedmont, but trust me, Scenic Avenue, 100% Baja. I park my car again in front of the yellow house. The lights are on in the kitchen. I know that kitchen. Teresa, please feed Foxy twice a day with the wet food and tuna mix I made for her in the fridge. The note Andrea left for me. Foxy, here, kitty, kitty. I have tuna. Okay, tonight I'm on a mission. In addition to getting the perfect sunset pic, I am looking for the very house that Jack London used to live in. Yeah, in this very neighborhood. Oh, but it wasn't Piedmont yet, back in his day, so it's cool. He still reps Oakland. I find the bungalow where they say that he wrote The Call of the Wild in while socializing with other art writers and artists of his time. Oh, and then according to Wikipedia, he took up a mistress or two, divorced his wife, but then built her a house around the corner. Ah, found it. Baja Piedmont just has a different vibe than the rest of the city. Or as Wikipedia puts it, the Bohemians of Piedmont were characterized by living non-traditional lifestyles, such as artists, writers, poets. But unlike their wealthier neighbors, the Bohemians of Piedmont cannot afford to have their homes constructed for them, but instead built them themselves. My people. Now, in the evenings when I'm not pursuing a perfect sunset, I'm content to walk around my immediate neighborhood. And before the quarantine, I only occasionally walked into the town of Piedmont. Most days, I'd walk to the border, turn around, go back to Oakland. And sometimes, during the fall season, off in the distance, I would hear the faint sound of an announcer over a loudspeaker and the muffled noise of a crowd. Oh, it's a football game at the high school. Oh, I gotta tell you, as someone who grew up in a small town as a cheerleader, nothing is more magical than Friday night lights. Especially if your football team is a good one and almost wins the championship. Almost. God, we were so close! I still hate Camp Lindo High School. I feel a magnetic pull towards Piedmont High. Maybe I should go to a game sometime. But now these days, during the quarantine, I'm not as tired as I used to be after working all week. So I keep walking into the town of Piedmont until I reach the football field. There's barricades at every entrance. Due to the pandemic, it is completely closed off to the public. Their football field has a big purple P in the middle of a perfectly green field. Huh. How did they get their football field to look so perfect? That's got to be AstroTurf, right? You know, fake grass. Hey, my high school, our football field had real grass. Man, what would it be like to go to school there? Have all that wealth and privilege. And then I remember. It's 1986, and I'm a high school cheerleader in a small blue-collar town of Martinez, which is 30 minutes east of Piedmont, and home of the Alhambra High School Bulldogs. A group of us cheerleaders find ourselves riding in a yellow school bus up the narrow, winding hills of Piedmont on our way to a preseason football game. Look at these houses.
This is Piedmont, folks.
I can't imagine coming home to one of these mansions and just throwing my books on the couch. These people are living high on the hog. As our cheer squad gets ready inside the girls' locker room, we overhear some mumbling coming from the other teen squad.
You are dogs.
Nice bangs. What's wrong with my bangs? I have good bangs. I kind of look like the lead singer of the Bengals.
Walk like an Egyptian.
Hey, okay, it's not like we're those girls from Antioch, all right? Their bangs are like... Why do rich kids have to be so mean? Mm-hmm. Well, our little blue-collar football team takes our resentment out on the field, and we kick their rich little asses, and we beat them 41-6.
Right. Learn how to play football, you spoiled wusses!
The 80s. Feeling a smug sense of satisfaction, I walk past the football field until I reach the campus of Piedmont Middle School. There's a big banner that says, "Welcome to PMS." That sign gets me every time. I remember the first time I saw that banner when I was new to the neighborhood many years ago. They were having a back to school night, and there were teachers, parents, and kids everywhere. And I remember thinking back then, if I had kids, I could have a 13-year-old daughter who dreads PMS. And just then I heard, "Hey, Team Money." It was Andrea. She was there with her daughter, Naomi, and her husband, Rick. Andrea, just a year older than me, married, two kids, the road most traveled. "Oh, hey, Andrea. I was just going on a walk. Naomi goes here?" "Yeah, well, we decided to rent in Piedmont for the schools, but there's not that many houses to rent in Piedmont, and I was starting to freak out. But then we just found a house like 2 weeks ago, right before the school year started." Of course she did. Andrea could get anything done. But now the campus of PMS is roped off with pandemic caution tape. Ooh, next up, the dog park. I remember when I first discovered this park. Tall eucalyptus trees, water cascades, birds, squirrels running amok. So peaceful. But now it's closed. And it was my shortcut to downtown Piedmont. Now I gotta keep walking around the park the long way. It takes some getting used to. One evening, I've made it to the middle of downtown Piedmont, and I have strayed a little too far off of my Oakland leash, and I gotta pee. No public restrooms are open. I see the closed dog park off in the distance. I mean, if I can cut through it, I can get home in time. Ugh! A Piedmont police officer is just sitting in his car outside the park. Seriously? These rich towns. I mean, can you imagine an Oakland police officer just sitting in his car patrolling a park? Oh, okay. The cop's not looking. I hop over the caution tape and I sprint through the entrance like it's chariots of fire. And as I'm running, all sorts of scenarios play out in my mind. "This is Officer Petty, the Piedmont Police. We have a runner." I run through the perfectly paved path and miss the bird, squirrel. I don't look back. I pass all the schools and I don't slow down until I land safely back in Oakland jurisdiction. Whew. That was a close one. The Piedmont Popo can't touch me now. And just then, I hear, oh, howling. But it's not coming from people. Oh, I mean, it's coming from people. It's 8 o'clock exactly. And I find out that people are howling every evening at 8 p.m. in solidarity with the frontline workers. Oh, okay. I got it. Oh, that one goes out to my sister who works at Costco.
The following week, another group text.
Good morning, everybody. Is everyone healthy? Prayer hands emoji. Just checking. Love, Mom. Me. I'm good. Mike. Good. Still working. Traffic's good. Steve. Lynn. There's a rumor that someone in the tire shop tested positive for COVID. Oh my goodness. Don't worry, Mom. Hazmat was called and they thoroughly disinfected the warehouse. Steve.
Paper's out of tortillas. Steve, learn how to make tortillas.
Your grandma Hortensia made tortillas every day. Here comes the recipe. 2 cups of flour, a dash of salt. Mom, Steve's not going to do all that. Half a cup of warm water, need to not sticky. Don't let these texts fool you. My mother has never, ever, to this day, made any of her children tortillas.
The next week.
Oh, new yard signs. Congratulations, class of 2020, Piedmont High School. Congratulations, class of 2020, Piedmont Middle School. Congratulations, class of 2020, Head Royce. Wait a minute. You mean, not only can some people afford to live in Piedmont, but their kids go to a private school as well? Trying to process the extravagance of it all, I keep walking until I reach the campus of Piedmont High School. Not closed off. I step onto the campus because I want to see how the rich kids live. I look through a window of what appears to be a storage room. There's boxes stacked one on top of one another that read, Metropolitan Van and Storage, Benicia Martinez. Of course, my little blue-collar hometown of Martinez supplies the storage units for the City of Piedmont High School. You're welcome. An outdoor amphitheater with a view of the bay? And you know darn well that this is not their only theater. My high school, our only stage was in the cafeteria. Oh, I'm sorry, multi-purpose room. The next evening, I'm back at that amphitheater getting sunset pictures. Oh, hello. I come here for the view sometimes. Oh. Do you go to school here? What year are you? Senior. Oh, you're a senior and you're graduating during a pandemic. I'm so sorry. That's weird. I thought my unspoken reaction would have been something more like, oh, you poor little rich kid, miss your prom? Wee. Well, you know what? You'll forget all about it in the fall once you set foot on your new college campus that mommy and daddy paid for. But I don't feel that way. I mean, that's probably not the case for every kid that goes to school here. Lord knows Andrea worked really hard to make sure that her kids got a good education. And besides, this kid can't help where he grew up. This is the only reality that he knows. Hey, my friend's daughter is a senior too. Do you know Naomi Binger? Oh, yeah. University of Vermont, right? Yeah, she's going there in the fall. I'm going to Rutgers. Oh, are you going to be living in the dorms? No, I'll be staying with my grandparents. Oh. What's your name? Max. Max Lee. Hello, Max. I'm Teresa. Friend of Naomi's mother. Max lets me know that the seniors are having staggered graduation ceremonies that coming Friday out on the football field. I found out Naomi is graduating at 4 p.m. and only faculty and parents are allowed to attend.
We'll see about that.
That Friday. Parking reserved for parents and teachers only. Hey, I could be a parent. I mean, what are they going to do? Arrest me? There's no cops around. I'm going in. Ugh, a parent volunteer. Hi, sorry, I can't let anybody in. but I can see her. That's Naomi, my friend's daughter. She's just right there in the 20-yard line. Oh, Naomi. Well, all right. Thanks. From the bleachers above, I take pictures of Naomi in her cap and gown, waiting for her name to be called. I feel my eyes swell up, and there's a lump in my throat. I can't believe it's graduation day already. It's bittersweet. It's August, 9 months earlier, and I am inside the cute yellow house on the corner in the living room. The hospice nurse comes out and I ask her, how's Andrea? She's highly medicated, so she's not in pain. Rick is with her right now. You can see her when he comes out. Just then I see Naomi and Andrea's best friend getting ready to leave. Where are you guys going? Shoe shopping. Naomi starts school tomorrow. Wow. Naomi is starting her senior year of high school, and her mother is dying of cancer. I watch Naomi walk down the football field to receive her diploma with her mask on. She loses her mother at the beginning of her senior year, and she graduates during a pandemic. And no amount of money can fix that. I get home and I post pictures of the graduation to Andrea's Facebook wall. Hey, Andrea. Look, I snuck into Naomi's graduation. You'd be so proud.
Yay. So I got one question today. Just one. What the fuck is wrong with people? Now, most of us have been able to wrap our heads around the whole no shirt, no shoes, no service thing, right? And why? Because no one wants to see your sweaty man tits and smell your fucking feet, all right? It's a magic consideration. No, it's an expectation, a demand for consideration of other fucking people. So why the fuck is it so hard to wrap your heads around a fucking mask?
Or better yet, wrap the mask around your fucking head. I can't believe people are reading this. Really? That's the hill you're gonna die on? Because I can guarantee you that is not the hill I'm gonna die on. I was just trying to get some groceries, for fuck's sake. And I see this woman, no mask, freaking out on this poor guy because he won't let her in the store. Also known as doing his job. And she's just going at him like he's the deep state in fucking incarnate, talking about like, we're all in on this conspiracy to silence people like her. I had to stop. I said, lady, look, no conspiracy here. I am all about your silence. Please. She gets all red, so tells me I'm a sheep and says, don't think they're not watching you too. Are you fucking kidding me? Of course they're watching me. I don't put a thing past our government, even before the Cheeto and Chief started this nightmare fucking joyride. So they're watching me. Does that mean I gotta be an asshole to the poor schmuck guarding the door at Whole Foods? No. And yeah, I shop at Whole Foods. Fuck you, they got good produce. Look. Bottom line, people, put the mask on your fucking face or stay the fuck home. Why? For the same reason you put on pants. Because this is a civilized fucking society. What? I'm on the computer. God, like, tell me every time you're always interrupting me. It's like, I can't even say anything anymore. If I see something wrong and try to do something about it, I'm going to get crucified. I have feelings, okay? I have a right to get what I ordered and to receive good customer service. Nervous. God forbid I mention that I specifically asked for extra foam. This is my special treat. Did I freeze? Anyway, since the shelter in place, I haven't gotten to have my cappuccino with extra foam every morning. I know we've all had to give up a lot. That was my thing. My indulgence. Now, I'm lucky to get it once every week or two. Every time I go grocery shopping or to run some other essential errand, I make sure to stop by my local Starbucks and get my cappuccino with extra foam. Is it wrong to want it the way I ordered it? If I say anything, no matter how politely I say it, as soon as they see that my name is Karen, I get that look. My name is Karen, okay? It doesn't make me a Karen. And if everyone could just respect... So I have a question for you. And it's an important question, so listen up. Did you wake up this morning in a free country? Think about that. Did you wake up in a free country? I did. And what's more, I woke up proud to live in a free country. The only place in the world where with a little hard work and perseverance, a person can truly be what they want to be. And that's the country I grew up in. And it's the country I will defend from the liberal elite who are now trying to take away my freedom to breathe. How dare you infringe on my most basic right? It's right there in the Constitution. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Breath is life. But now they want to take away my... They want to slap a mask over my nose and mouth and take away my breath, my liberty. And I'm sure they're not happy about it. Oh, and it's no coincidence that those masks, those death rags, are taking away our right to free speech. They are trying to silence us. Look at this. Do you think a liberal snowflake cries every time someone touches their face? And I haven't washed my hands today. You take that, Pelosi. But look. So I can't breathe, and I can't speak in public. Their solution is to stay home. Visit your family and friends on Zoom, where they can monitor our conversations. They are listening. Are you not seeing this? Bah, don't be a blind sheep. And you can kick me out of your elitist Whole Foods. And you can tell me to shut the F up, but I will not be intimidated, and I will not be silenced.
Having a body. What a daunting assignment. It's part of this crazy cosmic conundrum we're all wading through. Hard to live with one, can't live without one. What are you gonna do? Whether you like it or not, you're stuck in that thing, being you, serving out your life sentence. We struggle with this incarnation thing from the get-go. The great drum roll of conception, hundreds of millions of sperm vying for domination and control, battling their way upstream. Like salmon, knowing exactly where to go, and we have to imagine why, a journey so traumatic, only a rare few make it to the gate of heaven. The ones who do, pounding desperately at the door of the egg. Hey, please, open up. I've come all this way. As if there were soldiers at their back and nowhere to hide. The egg, coy, fickle, discerning God, she takes her time. While hello there, boys, assesses each suitor. And then, when she's good and ready, in a seduction known only to the divine, reaches out and draws one into her own. This holy consummation, this simultaneous orgasm of creation, calling forth a new universe into this vast, beautiful, quirky, chaotic order of things. At last, my love has come along, and my lonely days are over. And forget the cigarette and the postcoital banter. It's gestation time. God raises a baton, and a vast choir of angels calls down the one who shall be proclaimed as you. Cells dividing in their ancient human perfection. Unless, oh, whoops. Oh, I'm so sorry. Birth defects? I understand. I was born without a permanent tooth. You get used to it. There's an endless debate as to when this you actually even begins. Is it when that sperm and egg have their first kiss? Is it when that minuscule heart begins its tiny thumping? Is it when they inspect you for male or female on the ultrasound, the first intrusion into your sexuality? Or when you start kicking your mother awake in the middle of the night? Hey, what's a kid gotta do to get something to eat around here? Were you born out of wedlock? Conceived on a wedding night? Were you the result of months of hormones and IVF? Did you fly in, say, at the last minute from the Pleiades, here to put in the cameo appearance of a lifetime? Were there two mommies or daddies? Was one beige and one dark brown? Or was there a donor, perhaps a friend of a friend of a friend? Or was there perhaps an assault? And you will carry a lifetime of sorrow just there under the surface, waiting to emerge as anger, depression, the inability to have successful relationships, even after years of therapy. We continue getting bigger until it feels like, oh, I must be putting on weight. And thus, in perfect harmony between the mother and child, the great drama of the squeezing out begins. Our mother screaming, it feels demeaning, and the contractions seem to take forever as we traverse this life and death crisis in the great, excruciating arrival. Oh, wow. Well, that was something cast from the kingdom. What? Where the hell am I? Unless we have the rude awakening of Caesarean. No struggle. A little drugged, but okay. Well, that feels kind of nice. Here. No smushed head, no PTSD, just you there. You with the stars in your eyes, all plump and proper. Your mother's belly scarred for life, whatever. Rolled upside down as soon as they were out of that cozy, sweet, safe cocoon, and thwack. Welcome to planet Earth. The story was that my mother, of course, was tired. So follow this beautiful human logic. They took me away so that she could rest. The kid and me screaming, Mom! Though I didn't yet know English, so no one could decipher my cries. Oh, she's gonna be a handful. Girl's got a set of lungs on her. No, we're supposed to be seen and not heard. We're the only species that is so counterintuitive about so many things, but the birthing, the bonding, the welcoming, the antiseptic metal glare and gleam of it all, when we should begin quiet, skin to skin, when meeting our God, the mother, is reduced to a medical event. Back then, anyway, in the olden days, no doula rubbing her back, feeding her ice chips, no birthing pools, no Enya playing in the background. Who can say where the day goes, where the road flows? Only time. And your father, having my baby. What a lovely out of the loop, nervously pacing the waiting area, always with cigars, awaiting the great announcement, pink or blue, and thus the beginning of the insidious programming of you. Not there, holding your hand, cutting the cord, looking into your beautiful, miraculous face for the first time. Not much of anything save for that static blink of sperm donation. The joke in my family, when my father first set eyes on his wretched firstborn, was that he asked, can we send him back? His welcoming of the one who would be perceived as his dreaded lifelong competitor. Put up your dukes. Buster. I personally wouldn't have minded going back. Have perhaps been seeking a way home since the beginning of time, my time. This longing for a sense of safety, security, belonging that life just hasn't been able to provide. But we're born, even after this first series of insults, radiant. Joyful. Watch any baby who hasn't yet been traumatized or neglected yet. And everything is magic, filled with beauty. Dust floating in a shaft of light. Glitter on the throat of a hummingbird. Butterflies and dragonflies in the sweet sky blue of a robin's egg. Nursery rhymes and bedtime stories and the great do it again of swings and tickles and tosses in the air. It's all giggles and smiles. But sorry, Bunky, not for long. Turns out it's one fall from grace after another. Here's looking at you, kid. They were too polite to call me fat right away. But I was a chubby baby. And after a couple of months cooing at my mother's breast, it was a brash, brutal weaning and on to skim milk for me. I wonder what kind of desperation that sets up in the infant whose inner wisdom knows there isn't enough nourishment in that watery, rubbery bottle she's been given. The message, not enough, is plenty for you, young lady. Please, mommy, can I have some more? My body and its interaction with it soon became the domain of battle for its control. Take, for example, Exhibit A, my thumb. Excuse me. Sorry. A readily available object of comfort, an instrument of passion and peace, me, myself, and I wrapped around one another in deep bliss, which made my father furious, anticipating exorbitant orthodontia bills or the humiliation of a buck-tooth spawn. So young, he would rage, get that thing out of your mouth, or yank the offending hand and throw it halfway across the room. I wasn't terrified of him already, and I was close. I was quickly learning. This man was dangerous, and traitor he, trying to steal my comfort away from me. My hand was taped like a mummy at night. I peel it off. It was painted with a foul poison. I'd suck it off. I was mocked, humiliated, the shame meant to put and keep me in line. Who teaches us to manage our feelings? Who holds us when we're in pain? Sits with us when we're frustrated or overwhelmed, trying to navigate this new territory, life on earth, and these vehicles, our bodies. Whether it's a breast or a bottle or a binky, most often something gets shoved into our mouths at the first sign of fussiness. My thumb was a perfect fit, probably begun in the womb. Oh, he would finally win when I was about 10. No longer room for this infantile self-stimulation in the pre-teeny bopper world I was excitedly entering. And his obsession quickly turned to whatever else might be going into or coming out of my mouth. So rude. I'm 7. We live across the street from Patty Sampson. She's a whole year older than me. We're friends. 101 Dalmatians is my favorite movie of all time. Cruella de Vil, Cruella de Vil. She's like a spider waiting for the kill. And we play puppies. I'm always Rolly, chubby one. I'm hungry, mother. Really, I am. Now, Rolly, you just had your supper. But I'm hungry all the same. I'm so hungry, I could eat a whole elephant. Observing the world around me, I quickly came to gather that, real women don't need to eat. You know, the lettuce leaf with the scoop of low-fat cottage cheese and the iced tea with the lemon wedge and just a little sprinkle of sweet and low. Oh, more than enough for a dainty, petite, wannabe growing girl. Well, I'm so full I couldn't eat another bite. I studied the other girls, the pretty ones with perfect teeth and straight hair. The ones whose mothers got them kids in various colors, not those clodhopper black and white saddle shoes I was forced to wear because I had flat feet. Already, I was competing and comparing, jealous, flailing. They got peanut butter and jelly on Wonder Bread and whole Hershey bars in their lunch bags, not tongue sandwiches on rye with Miracle Whip, not those dry, boring cardboard celery and carrot sticks my mother wrapped in wax paper. I'm 11. My favorite things are dogs, rock and roll, and dancing on the playground. Come around, around the world. Are you ready for a brand new beat? I win twists and lip sync contests. I'm already a little boy crazy and cheer my spit contests. My mother takes me to our pediatrician, Dr. McIntosh. He looks me over. Oh, let's take a look at you, young lady. Puts me on the scale. Up you go there. Takes a step back. Oh, you've been putting a wee bit of the pudge on now, aren't you? And prescribes to my mother that it's time for me to start to diet. And this is born a self-obsession, a self-definition that I will carry with me throughout the rest of my life. Something is wrong with me. My body is living proof. I start sneaking food and stealing quarters from my father's dresser, two at a time, for junkus schmogunkus, stuff I shouldn't be eating. I admit it. God grant me the serenity. I'm already a sugar addict. I quickly come to hate my body. You know how that goes. Too big, too tall, too unwieldy. I'm getting breasts. Yay. I'm going to start my period soon. Boo. I have hair on my legs and my mother won't let me shave for God's sake. She says, you're too young for that sort of thing. Oh, I sneak that too. Cut myself up to smithereens. My older brother, 3 years my senior, once someone I could actually look up to, my hero. As I grew, quickly became shorter and smaller than me. Her mother had smoked when she was pregnant with him, and people started thinking I was the big sister. He, of course, cooties. Another no win for him, vis-a-vis our handsome, charming, 6 foot father. So duh. I start to slouch, much to the disdain of said father, who's always shoving his fingers in my back at the dinner table. Sit up straight, Quasimodo. I'll take dysfunctional families for 1,000, please, Alex. Somehow, in his royal, grandiose vision, I was supposed to be able to dine with the queen. I was supposed to be a lady.
I ain't no lady.
This rigorous training of table manners and its resulting insubordination soon became part of the battle in our nightly war zone, his rage ruling while my mother slapped slabs of liver on our plates and scooped the frozen peas. His fist slamming the gleaming wood as he commanded us pitiful plebs, elbows, don't eat with your fingers. How dare you speak to me that way? God forbid you should chew with your mouth open. Then it was off with her head and sentenced to our rooms. Don't upset your father. He had grown up during the Depression. He and his parents living in his grandmother's boarding house, and his dream, king of the castle, had always been to have his own fine dining domain. Strangers at the table, he'd reminisce. Hobos, businessmen, immigrants, the only child, so well-mannered, so promising. The story was he always got the heart of the lettuce, the tarnished gold spoon already clanking around in his mouth. My mother, soon downwardly mobile, moved from one semi-palatial house to the next, not so nice. From flat to apartment, from hired help to being her own scullery maid, as my grandfather, her father, struggled to make ends meet, and strangers were jumping out of windows as the stock market crashed. They had landed in this new world, and apparently it was up to me to prove them a success. I would wonder what the cool girls from school were having for dinner, Dee Dee March and Leah Rossman and Kim Mooring, who had nice parents, Chevy Caprice wagons with real fake wood paneling on the side and long, straight, little girl hair. They were the popular girls, waspy preteens who soon would be taking their daddy's credit cards to Judy's and Macy's to shop in the juniors department, studying their future selves in the glossy pages of 17 magazine. What I didn't know then, how could I, was that eventually, life grueling as it can be, one would die from an overdose, one would live off and on with her parents, well into her 40s, and the other, so disappointed, would have three kids from three different men, never married. So much for the American dream. Me, I, the one with the big nose and the coarse frizzy hair, my mother, once a year, doing her duty, dragging herself behind me from store to store where nothing fit. Not quite yet Lane Bryant, but no longer JCPenney's. So in my high school days, hippie wannabe, it was peasant blouses, pants from the Army Navy store, and Mexican shawls I did my best to wrap myself up and hide in. Such a pity. If only she put in a little effort, she could have been quite a pretty girl. My father, wouldn't you like a nice pantsuit instead of that? I knew, no matter what, no matter how hard I tried, unlike my peers, I was never going to be.
As usual, we'll begin by beaming love at one another. That's nice. Thank you all for being in my garden, this new virtual garden we're all learning to love. Learning to love. You know, that is quickly becoming one of my new favorite phrases. It's like a hero's quest. All roads lead back to love. And you know, the less likely it seems, the more fun I have finding my way there. I've been making it to a game. It's like a dessert after my gratitude journals. A dessert I can eat all day long without feeling guilty. What can you learn to love today? Is it being a homebody? More time with the kids, eating canned goods, whatever it is, I hope you take the time to really have some fun with it today. Oh, shit! Sometimes I get really stressed out that I don't think I could handle being tortured. Like, I know that sounds so rando, but it really stresses me out. Like, seriously, please don't trust me with any state secrets or whatever, because as soon as they wheel in the dental tools, I'm spilling all the pee. I can't even look at it.
like, I'm a huge horror fan, but I can't watch any body horror. Like, not if it's at all realistic. It stays with me, you know? Like, remember that scene in the first Pet Sematary when that evil zombie baby kills Fred Willard? Wait. Not Willard. Not Wilfred Brimley. Whoever he is, he comes in with a knife because he knows the baby is bad, and he's all, come on out, I got something for you. And then you just hear the baby laughing, like, and then, so not Wilfred Brimley goes to look under the bed, but then the zombie cat distracts him. And when he turns around, you see this little hand come out from under the bed with a scalpel. And he just slowly cuts right through Fred Willard's Achilles tendon. And then he like turns around and he's like, oh! And then as he opens his mouth to scream, the evil baby cuts across it and splits the sides. And then he like falls to the ground. And as he falls to the ground, the baby like jumps on him and starts tearing at his throat with his teeth. I really wish I could remember the name of that actor. Fred Sanford? Anyway, the point is that even though I haven't seen that since I was a kid, it still really bothers me. Like, in my body, I think I just have a really high level of, what's the word? Empathy. I'm highly empathetic. Oh, by the way, if you are wondering about any of the products that I'm using, be sure to click the link in my bio and be sure and buy directly from the link because you get a discount and I get the credit. Thank you.
Let me hear your speech. No, I'm probably not going to stick to it anyway. Okay, fine. Honorable governors, the Accrediting Commission has utterly failed in its charge to ensure educational quality. Its practice of fraud and corruption, year after year, carried on systematically and intentionally, has harmed tens of thousands of our students. Immigrants, working class, Black and brown students, their dreams put on hold, their aspirations not realized. This should deeply trouble our moral sensibilities. It is time to replace the Accrediting Commission. Brilliant. As usual. Okay, now you. Honorable governors, dump the Accrediting Commission, restore democracy to City College, and fire the STWEP. Yes, you heard that right. STWEP, special trustee with extraordinary powers. That was his official title. You can't make this stuff up. You know, I know you're the queen of 30-second sound bites, but you do have 3 minutes. What? Ah! Why did Greg leave me? Love dies. It just does. He waxes eloquently for the Board of Governors, but for me, sound bites? No. Platitudes? love just dies? I've been married 4 times. How did you last 32 years? We had a good relationship. I thought. Each night, riding home on my motorcycle, I feel anticipation, wondering what wonderful thing Greg has been cooking for me. Mapo tofu, strange chicken. Hey, I'm home. What's for dinner? How was your day? Hey, did you write in your beautiful cookbook? I get laid when I make this? It's green chicken curry. The engine test went really well. That EEP database you made for us really has things running so smoothly. EEP. Engine Emissions and Performance. Cute acronym. I hope Alden is sorry that he called me the database Nazi. How was your day? I organized 2 dozen people to go to Sacramento and give public comment. Each testimony was more compelling than the last. Didn't make a damn difference to those bastards. City College is doomed. Poor baby. Never mind. Give me the update on the latest drama between Susan and Alden. Do they both come to your mandatory mid-afternoon latte breaks? No. Alden won't even be in the same room with her. He says she's a drunk. Well, she did spend 60 days in jail for her drinking, and he doesn't even know that. Didn't they used to be really good friends? Yeah, but that was 16 years ago. Now he keeps telling me to fire her. He said that the SoCal air quality management engine test last week, she totally screwed it up. And then she blamed the client. I think we're going to lose that contract. Really? And you're not going to fire her? She's been having a tough time going through divorce. She brought her son Ty to the Berkeley Marina today after work. I'm teaching him how to pilot. Oh, just you or with the guys in your NADA club? NADA club changed its name. We are now a drinking club with a flying problem. That's perfect. How old is Ty now? Oh, 9 or 10. Really cute kid. Really messed up over his parents splitting up. You are so good with kids. I'll bet it's super helpful to Susan right now. After dinner, Greg goes to work on one of his RC planes. I think it's the P-40B Flying Tiger that I got him for Christmas. When I'm done with the dishes, I pick up my latest sewing project. A cropped herringbone blazer with bell sleeves. An item of clothing I need solely for the joy it will spark in my closet. Greg, look how cute this is. Yeah, it's adorable. Looks like the other one you have. No, it doesn't. Hey, look at how this wing fits like a glove on the fuselage. Oh, crap. The fastener on the landing gear failed. Oh, poor baby. What? It's the fastener on his landing gear. On the P-40B Tiger. Let's just go to bed. Are you thinking about the annotation in your cookbook? Greg insists that we go to bed together at the same time each night, even if we're too tired to make love. He likes to fall asleep cuddling. I do too. In the morning, Greg is instantly awake, cheerful, jumping out of bed to make coffee.
Another day in paradise.
Can you make those damn birds shut up? Why do they have to chirp so loudly? They're God's creatures. Oh, the perfect amount of foam. Thank you.
Hey, I have to go to Europe in August. You'll still be on sabbatical. Come with me.
No. Remember Sweden? I don't mind being a tourist by myself during the day, but in the evenings, I want to be with you. We spent every night with your boring, uptight business friends. They made us eat outside just because it was midsummer. It was 50 fucking degrees out, freezing and raining. Well, Swedes have their traditions. We got to be apart. And you got to argue all night with Matthias. I wasn't going to let that remark about Obama pass. He's not used to women being so outspoken. He thinks I'm berserkly. He's from Texas. Is there anything you two agree on? But you know what you're talking about. He respects that. They all love you. You're my perfect trophy wife. Come on, I want to show you off in Vienna. But I go to Palestine at the end of August. You can fly there from Vienna. Well, would you come to Palestine after you're done? We can meet in Derebzia at Deeb's house. If I didn't have to go through the Zionist entity, but traveling through Israel with an Arab last name ain't gonna happen. Besides, monitoring checkpoints and intervening in midnight army raids, that does not sound like my kind of fun. Oh, this trip is going to be different. I got accepted to the Fellowship of Reconciliation artist delegation. We're going to paint murals in the West Bank. And I'm going to see Netta's new baby. And I'll be able to spend some time with Deeb and his family in Derebzia. And at the end, Elizabeth is going to come and join me. We're going to do a bicycle tour in the hills south of Hebron. It's going to be fun. I'll stick with the fun in Vienna. Come on, time to get going. 3 times a week before work, Greg and I like to go to the gym. There's a clique of gym rats there at the Y that we really enjoy hanging with. One of them joins us on the reclining bikes. You two are the sweatiest, I mean sweetest couple I know. Greg and I go our separate ways to work. He's got his own engineering consulting company in Oakland. He's a big fish in the little pond of large reciprocating engines. You know, the kind that power ships or generate electricity off the digester gases at sewage plants. Me? I'm an engineer too. I have 2 degrees from esteemed institutions to prove it. I fell into teaching at City College when I got laid off my first engineering job out of school. I love my job at City College of San Francisco, but my vocation is activism. And Greg supports me. Even when my arrests tipped over 50, jumping over the fence at Lawrence Livermore National Labs landed me 30 days in Santa Rita. But Greg supports my causes. Our causes. He doesn't think I'm abnormal. He doesn't think I'm abnormal. My sisters do. My first foray into activism was in the early 80s. I was 27 years old. You're abandoning your family for 3 weeks to go to Nicaragua? You haven't even been married for 6 months. Cheryl, our government is funding the Contras to attack civilians in a poor country. It's especially bad right now in Jalapa, a village in the north on the border with Honduras. So you'll take the bullet instead? No, they won't shoot if they know Americans are there. Well, who's going to take care of Christina? Greg, of course. He's proud of what I'm doing. Picking coffee. Accompanying campesinos who just want to work their land, build their country, and defend their revolution. A revolution that overturned a brutal dictator. A dictator that our government supported. Let's talk about that. No, you're just going to get all preachy and know-it-all on me. And besides, I don't like to argue. She could have fooled me. That summer, Greg and I do go to Europe, and we have fun. On the day he drops me off at the Vienna, at the Vienna airport for my flight to Tel Aviv, we stop in front of the Hofbräu for one of our kissing pictures. I confess to him that I'm nervous to go through the border. You know, Israel has a policy of denying activists entry. You're Jewish, you're white, you're middle-aged. I know you mean old. I don't fit the profile, but still, I'm nervous. It'll be fine. I'm in line for at passport control at Ben Gurion Airport. I'm scoping out the agents. I want to pick out the one that seems least interested in the job. You, go sit on that bench over there. Greg, I don't think they're gonna let me in. I'm on it. I'll call the California ISM office and tell them to get an Israeli lawyer on your case right away. And I'll mobilize your network of supporters, have them flood the US embassy with calls. Thank you so much. Eventually, I'm escorted into a tiny room with a giant desk and a small chair in front. The bald guy behind it is wearing sunglasses, even though we're inside. There's a bright window behind him so that I have to squint when I look at him. This is your name, Kaufmyn, K-A-U-F-M-Y-N. Yeah, I changed it to get the man out. My father didn't like it too much. Your father is a proud Jew. Your father is a proud Jew. Why are you here? Will you go to the West Bank? last time you went to the West Bank. My friend Netta is waiting for me in Tel Aviv. She just had a baby. Netta Yahav. It's important to let him know I have Israeli friends. You are not allowed to participate in violent activities. Can I participate in nonviolent activities? You live in the US. You can express your opinion there. We know you are part of ISM. We have pictures of you in Jerusalem. It is not a crime to be part of ISM, but you must respect our country. I thought Israel was a democracy. It is our democracy. If you want to participate in a demonstration, you must get a permit. Oh, okay. How do I obtain a permit? I look calm and unruffled, don't I? My heart is beating so hard, I am sure he can hear it. After 2 hours of this, he takes my passport and stamps it with a denied entry. They take me to the detention center where they're deporting others, mostly African and Filipinos. They put me in a room with Dasa, a young woman from Romania. She is pissed. She was set up to do a journalism internship at a Palestinian newspaper in Ramallah. She was totally caught off guard. Didn't have a clue as to the political situation here. As she rallies against the Israelis, oh wait, her punk haircut is incongruous with the frilly pink tee and huge bow in front. As she rallies against the Israelis, the bow jerks and dips and exposes frequent glimpses of her breasts. The soldier comes to the door, looks at Das's bow. Cigarette break? She jumps up and I follow. This is only for those who smoke. I just started. Oh, while ISM tries to work their legal magic to fight my deportation, a lovely woman from the US Embassy comes to see me. She tells me there's nothing that they can do and leaves me with some fashion magazines. A couple hours later, I hear from ISM. I can sit in detention for a month while they fight the deportation, but they're pretty sure they're gonna lose. Plus, I'll have to fork up $10,000. I decide it's not worth my time or my money. I go to sleep that night on the upper bunk with Dasa smoking below me. I was told that at 6:30 I'd be put on a plane. I wake up at 6:15 and decide that they lied. At 6:20, a goon shouts that I should gather my things together. At 6:25, I'm in a car on the tarmac. At 6:30, I'm being escorted up the jetway. I stop at the top. Where's my passport? I will give it to the pilot. I am not getting on this fucking plane without my passport. He gives it to me. He escorts me to the very last row of the plane. The passengers are all belted in, waiting for takeoff. They stare at me, wondering why I'm getting such special treatment. He sits me down in the last row and gives me a piece of paper. It's in Hebrew. What does it say? Sign it. It says that you were responsible for the flight, the cost of this flight. I'm denied entry into your fucking country? I'm forced on a plane to go somewhere I don't want to go? And now you're saying I have to pay for it? Let me off this plane right now. He leaves without my signature. Those fucking Israelis. They send me to Vienna, even though my return ticket home is through London. Plus, there's an 8-hour layover in Warsaw. The flight attendant tells me to wait till everybody else is off the plane. Then she delivers me to two incredibly attractive beefcake Polish soldiers wearing black t-shirts, tight black t-shirts, camouflage pants, and combat boots. They each sport an AK-47. It says, deported. Why? I'm a terrorist. A tourist? No, I was trying to participate with Palestinians in their protests against Israel's occupation. A terrorist. Zamahovians. 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 Why doesn't he think an old woman can be a terrorist? I walk away. They follow at a polite distance. I camped out on one of the airport benches thinking I'll take a nap. They watch me. I go up to go to the bathroom. They wait outside the door. I tell them, you don't need to sit here with me and babysit for 8 hours. You don't want to watch me cry. Go. They're not getting it. Okay, you two, go. Bye-bye. Me, I'll fly away. Nobody gets into trouble. Dziękuję bardzo. Dziękuję bardzo. You're welcome. I get into Vienna at about 9 o'clock that night. Greg has already arranged a car, a hotel room, and a flight to London the next day. I go down to the hotel bar to get a beer and process the last 36 hours. I was mad and depressed, really angry, and my heart was filled with love and gratitude for Greg, who had taken such good care of me in this time of crisis. I am so lucky to have him. Thank you.
I remember long after I was a very little girl, a virus swept across the whole world. Why, I'll never forget the look on my bartender's face as he sang his last call and said there'd be no more happy hours. Not for a long, long while. And for months, I stayed in my pajamas and watched the whole world appear on Zoom. And as I stared at me, staring back from the screen, I said to myself, is that all there is to a plague? Is that all there is? Is that all there is? If that's all there is, my friend, paint. Then let's keep dancing. Let's break out the boo. If that's all there is.
Yay! I just want to thank all the performers tonight, Theresa Donahoe, Wynd Kaufmyn, Johanna Courtleigh, and Ady Abbot for their show tonight. And thank you all for being here, joining us tonight. And come back to the marsh often. Good night.